The next tip I want to share with you is the dynamics of your play. Dynamics. What is dynamics? The first time I heard that word dynamics, I was like, wow, dynamics. Dynamics is just talking about volume. Don't let anybody bamboozle you with words. So volume, the volume of your play, the dynamics of your play, how hard you play affects the tone of your sax. How hard you play affects the tone of your sax. Now, if I want to play now, and I can play, I can also play, I can also play dynamics. It affects the sound I'm going to get on my saxophone. Vera Sax demonstrate what I just did. I want you to blow. You see that? You see the same thing I blow. I can also play. So that is the difference. This, if you notice the one I was playing in music production, that's what they call clipping. Clipping of sound. When the microphone is too loud, it starts clipping. It starts having this uncontrolled picking. Don't like it. You see, there's a clipping. But if I'm also on this other side, very low, it's too low. So what do you do at that point is stay at the middle. So when you're blowing, don't make sure that you have the microphone is good, and then you are not clipping on the microphone, and then you are just on the middle. So when over time you just develop that dynamics of yourself, and then whether I'm excited or I'm not excited, this is where I stay. Now, but when we come to articulation, and then you are now improvising on stage, you can add dynamics to what you are actually playing. So instead of staying in one dynamics, you can stay, you can go high, you can even at a point create some kind of a silence in your play. You know, the jazz is going, let me just put the whole dynamics together, and then you can, I'm not telling you to throw away any of them, but depending on the spirit of the play at that point, you cannot be, but averagely, normally, you should stay in the middle. So let's go. I can start a music like. You see, dynamics depend, and the instrumentalists, they are guiding you. When they are low, you are low. There's no point, pastor say, drop, bring it down. And then if you don't know how to play soft, and you don't have a volume control on your sax, and you know you are not the one on the mixer, you are not the one on the sound console, so you can't, most of the microphone you have for saxophone, you may not be able to regulate the volume while playing. So dynamics, practice high, practice middle, practice low. And then over time, when you want to determine the kind of tone you want to be known with, there are some saxophonists that they like playing more on the high sax. So you hear most of their saxophonists, especially the rock musicians, they like on the high side. Everything, especially even the glory. I think I'm going to teach all of this. This is the growling technique. The growling technique takes you even beyond the clipping side of what I'm just seeing. That one, you want to even create a kind of, that's why at that point you're now humming, you're even humming into the saxophone to get that rock, hockey and rocky kind of sound. So depending on the kind of genre you're playing, the kind of music you're playing, you can also determine the kind of dynamics to stay with. I hope I've helped you with that. That's a very important tip. And then the last thing I want to talk about is the embouchure. Your embouchure determines the kind of toll you're going to get from the saxophone. Now, your embouchure, I've taught that in our last, in our, almost in the first class, yeah, no, second or first class. Please check the links below for the classes that you missed. Now, the right embouchure is the pronunciation of the letter F. 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 Now, some of, I saw some people playing that, and because I told them to put their lips under, I mean their teeth under their lower lips, they now did like, it will blow. But for you to seriously tore in your lips, your lower lips like that, have effect on your, you are going to have a dull sound. You know that what it means is that more of that lips is resting on your reed, affecting the vibration. So you don't want to, you don't want to carry all the leaves and just put under the mouthpiece and stop the vibration. So especially for those that have big leaves, people have to make sure that, you know, you want to make sure that your leaves is not really affecting or disturbing. You want to, no, it will affect. So just F, a little, see, a little of the mouth, you just as you like the teeth, see, F. This is the best. So look at where my teeth is falling. It's not falling inside. My teeth is actually just at this one. If you are too far, if you are outside, there's problem. If you are too far inside, there's problem. Just stay at the middle for a good tone. Now, I haven't gotten that. The next thing you need to get is the position. How deep is the mouthpiece into your mouth? If it's not too deep on the tip on this side of this, on this side, just like this, I'm saying at the tip of the mouthpiece, I don't get sound. This is because the tip of the mouthpiece will actually vibrate. That's where the vibration is ignited. So if I'm at the tip, I am what? I'm stopping it, the vibration. So don't say at the tip. If I'm at the end, look at it. I'm allowing much of the vibration to come from the whole length of the reed. So like, see what I'm going to get. One kind of, let me put it inside the saxophone so that you see what I'm saying. At the tip, no sound. At the middle, good sound. At the too far inside, loud clipping. Even it's even worse if it's on the low. Then no, it's not good. So just stay at the middle, it affects your tone. Some of these things we unlearn them after thinking that we are already playing, people are already inviting us here and there. You remember? So we have to come back and get our head straight. So watch this video and get things right. So stay at the center. Yes, you have a question.
What about some people that do put their mouthpiece?
Yes, some people put their mouthpiece at the, I know, can someone, let me give you an example, someone that do that, Kenny G. Kenny G plays the saxophone like this. It will work, but the problem is that if you have not mastered it, more of my air was not coming out of this side. And then another effect of this is that my air is not directed straight into the saxophone, so it's kind of going sideways. Then it will now corner. You are giving your air a lot of corner to follow. How Kenny G was able to master it, that is for him. But on the normal conventional way, let your sax stay straight at the middle. Here is better, and then you are there. So it's better, it will do, but you have early sound and so on and so forth. Having said all of this, let me just advise some of us. When I start teaching you altissimo, there are a lot of things that what we call the overtone series. A lot of things may change in your embouchure. Sometimes you might have to go whichever way you can to just get that, because overtone is not the conventional saxophone fringing, where you are going to be having this after your normal conventional saxophone fringing chart, where you have your B flat. This is where saxophone stops conventionally. Now, when you now begin to want to go beyond the F and the F sharp, you now begin to go, and then you now want to go. I and then you want to now go to that autismo side, a lot of things might change. You might have to even bring out more of your lips to accommodate more strength, and then some you might have to, you know, come out a little bit from the middle where you were outside to get a very, to really restrict the saxophone, the reed, from making such vibration that will not give you that high. You know, the faster the vibration or the length of it that is vibrating, the higher sound you get. If you want to get lower sound, some of you that are still learning, you are trying to get that low sound, it's not giving you. Allow more of the reed, the length of the reed to what? To vibrate. Sometimes you need to even go in to get that low sound. It means you're allowing more of the reed to vibrate. So this is plus or minus, this is what you need. Let me hold this. If I'm biting up, my lower lip is going to be here. So the reed is good. If I'm biting straight, this is the reed. If I'm biting the other way, look at it. This is what's happening. So stay here. And then if you want to get a low note, bite up and stay here. If you want to get the medium good sound that I desire for you, you stay kind of in the middle. But if there are some multisimo registers that you might want to get, that you might really even want to restrict the vibration of your reed. I hope you get that. That is that for that. And I hope there are other things that affect your sound, as the tone of your sax. A lot of people have asked me this question. Does painting of my sax, spray painting my sax the way I did to this, does it really affect the tone of the saxophone? This is the color that came with this guy. It came like this. Leave your sax like this if you can. Do your best to leave your sax like this. But over time, your sax gets rusted, and then you want to create some, you don't want to just appear tattered and your sax is looking like one of these old time saxophonists that we have. You just want to look modern and look, you want to just give your sax a color, customize it for yourself. I do that a lot. Some of you, if you want me to really paint your sax and get your sax sounding, still sounding well, that is one of my job now as a musician over the years. So you leave your sax like this, but when you begin to have rust and you're not happy with this color, it doesn't really match with your brand again, just go ahead. You can spray paint, but just make sure that the tone of your, the texture of the paint you are using is not too thick to really affect the sax. But on a normal, on the average, browse it anywhere, the answer you're going to get is spray painting your sax does not in any way affect the tone of your sax. So, but when you begin to put too much of paint that is so thick, then what happens is that those paint begin to block some of the moving parts of the sax. You begin to, there are some parts that is supposed to be moving. When you stock those places with the paint, they will, and then the paint now dry up, it's going to really affect. In fact, there are some paint that when you now they will stuck into the mouth of your holes. That's the pads. Some they can really, your pad will not close well because some paints are around the circles. They are really disturbing the closing of. But if you have a professional, someone that really know what to do when it comes to spraying your sax for you, it will not affect your tone. And then the next question, the next thing that bothers your mind is, what brand of sax will give me a professional sound? If you have all this I've taught you in place, your mouthpiece is in place, your reed, you know how to adjust your reed, you know the placement of your mouth, you know dynamics of play, you know how to tune your sax to the E-flat that we just taught you, you know all this, and then the next thing you might want to just do to help your sound as a professional is to just upgrade the brand that you use, the brand of sax that you use. So you can upgrade to Yamaha, you can upgrade to Selma, you can upgrade to Mendini, you can upgrade to some of those professionally recommended brands. You can just upgrade to whatever. But price on the low side, on the medium side, on the learning side, any saxophone, Premier England, whatever you want to pick, you know, Armstrong, all those saxophones, they are good saxophones that will give you a good sound, provided you know what you are doing. The other tips that affects your tone, I'm not going to share it in this class, except you want me to do a 3 hours class for you. So, but of course, that's why we have it every Tuesday. The difference between this this note and but as you can blow straight like at the same time, I can also play that. The tone different. So techniques can really affect the kind of tone that comes from your sax. We are not talking about the techniques aspect of your tone now in this case. We're not talking about the normal analog or the talking about the instrument itself. What you need to put in place. You are not the problem now. This sax, now when I now give two people the same sax, everything is in order. How they now sound differently depends on the techniques that you're going to be learning shortly in this channel. I was able to over time, which as I grew up in saxophone, I was able to learn some of these techniques that really helped me and some of these tips that I've just shared with you. Then, and now most of those I used to excuse the tone. I heard a lot of great saxophonists. I just excuse it. It's the kind of sax I'm using, Jerry. If I'm using their kind of sax, you know how much my sax? My sax is just how many dollars? How many? Just 45,000 naira, 30,000. They are using 250,000 naira. That I'm talking of naira now, Nigerian currency. Now I just excuse it until one day one of such great saxophonists came. Jerry Omoli just came where I was learning there. Why? That was about talking about something like 10 to 14 years ago. And then he came and just took this sax and blew it. The same sax I was using there. He kind of left his sax in the hotel room and then he didn't bring it and then they asked him to play. So he just said, okay, young man, just give me. I just gave him the same sax, the same reed, everything. Wow. I said, man, then the problem was not the sax. The problem at that point was I was doing a lot of things wrong. Because I noticed that when he picked my sax, he brought out the reed. First thing, he changed the reed. Then he just adjusted the whole thing, put everything in order, fix it, and then the guy was a lot of vibration. Like, wow, so this thing is not like an effect coming from the microphone, but actually from the player of the saxophone. So I'm going to learn a lot of things. So I hope you've learned something today, Verasax.
Wow.
What are you going to say today? We learned so many. I hope I've not bombarded you with so many information
today. For those of you that are new to this channel, subscribe.
Why should they subscribe?
You're going to be learning a lot of things. Like today's one, I've learned so many today.
That reminds me, if I'm not able to upload all of this, because today we took our time in the studio teaching, just teaching. By the time I go to edit, I don't know how long it will take. If it takes too long, I'm going to break it. I'm going to just post it. Whether you if you're a subscriber, you'll see it.
Yeah.
If you're not a subscriber, you won't see it. So that's one of the reasons why they subscribe. Because if I'm not able to upload everything I taught today on Tuesday, you will receive an alert on Thursday telling you that I've uploaded the part B of this same class. And then for those of you that are still waiting for me to send you links about the saxophone various, I'm going to, I didn't have the time to take those products that I really wanted to get today. Today I just taught you generally. So in the next, as we go on in this class, just be patient with me. I'm going to really have that time to give you why I asked you to choose this type of brand and this type of brand. And then I'll actually even send you links that you can go and get those things right from where I'm getting mine also. All right, guys. Thank you. See you next Tuesday. Bye.